Ready to go? Okay, good afternoon. Welcome everyone to this informational meeting of the Pennsylvania House Transportation Committee. We are convening here in G50 or the Irvis office building in Harrisburg. Joining us today are representatives from a company by the name of DriveWise, who are here to answer the question, why do those way stations always stay empty and seem to have chains across the entrances saying they're closed as I drive up and down around the state? We had handled House Bill 1410 back in June of this year, and we passed it out of committee back toward the end of June. It was assigned to Rules after its first reading on the House floor, and that's where it stays today in the Rules Committee. But the prime sponsor of House Bill 1410, dealing with this bypassing of way stations, Mindy Fee, Representative Mindy Fee, is here with us today. And after I ask my co-chairman if he has any opening remarks, I'll turn to you and ask for you to talk about House Bill 14 and what you fill us in on what we're going to hear today. Okay?
Thank you, Chairman, and I would like to thank the committee. I actually like to thank the committee for a unanimous vote back in June when we passed this out of the Transportation Committee. And this was brought to my attention, and what really stuck out to me is nearly all the other states have this technology. And the truckers are on board, and it seems to be working in all the other states. So I know Chairman Carroll, at the end of our vote in the committee, had asked for to hear technically how it works. So I'm going to just let you guys go on and explain to the committee, and I look forward to hearing now what you have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I guess the next thing that we should do is call the roll, please, Pam. Here.
Brown. Culver. She's virtual. Fee. Heffley. Coffer.
Here.
Lawrence.
Here.
Marshall. Ms. Gorski. Mostello,
here.
Rothman, Schmidt,
here.
Schroeder, she's virtual.
Yes.
Stevens, Warner, Chairman Carroll,
here.
Davis,
leave.
Gainey, Heron,
leave.
Hohenstein,
leave.
Inamorato, she's virtual. Kinsey,
leave.
Mullins,
leave.
O'Mara,
leave.
Warren.
Okay, thank you. For those of us who are joining us virtually, if you have any questions you'd like to address to the witnesses, please email Meredith Bajica at mbigica@pahouse.net or James Bowes, sitting here to my right, at jbowes, B-O-W-E-S, at pahousegop.com. Next, we turn to Mark Nichols and Rick Kuntz from DriveWise to educate us on how this program works and why those way stations even exist today and whether or not their future is limited because of the new technology you've developed. Briefly on the internet, I was able to find out that DriveWise is the largest provider of this kind of way station avoiding software, if you will. The largest provider in North America. So you're probably in a real good spot to tell us how this works and what the future holds for us in terms of the trucking industry in Pennsylvania and across the nation. With that, Mark, please introduce yourself.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Mark Nichols. I'm the Director of Government and Industry Relations for DriveWise. I'm a retired major from North Carolina State Highway Patrol, ran motor carrier operations and special ops for 30 years. I'm currently still a law enforcement officer. I can't get it out of my blood, so I serve as a special deputy for the Sheriff of Johnston County, Steve Bizzle. I've been with the company for 10 years, and that is my position today. And we're glad to be here, and thank you for the hospitality. Coming from North Carolina, it means a lot.
Well, welcome.
Thank you.
I love the Irish accent, too, by the way. Mr. Kuntz?
Thanks, sir. My name is Rick Kuntz. I'm a retired corporal from the Pennsylvania State Police. And hometown boy, I live up in Bedford. And I've been with DriveWise, I guess, 6 years. And very anxious to tell you about the program and how it can enhance operations with state police here in Pennsylvania.
Okay, well, you're joined fraternally by Harry Donauer here for the Pennsylvania State Police as well.
Yes.
As a witness to today's hearing. With all that being said, I think it's time for us as committee members to simply sit back and have you tell us both in words and by video what this system is, how it works, whether it has any pitfalls at all, and what it bodes for the future.
Absolutely, sir. We're going to pull the slideshow up. We actually have a presentation. There's not many slides, but I think it directs a lot of attention to the safety aspects of why we're here today. Okay. And let me start off by saying, first of all, being in law enforcement, my career, this technology is about bringing safety to your state. It's to augment patrol operations, and that is why we're here today to talk about safety for the drivers, the motorists, and for the troopers. There is a reason why we're here, so we're very excited. So again, we're talking about DriveWise Bypass and Program Connected Truck Vehicle Technologies. I don't know who's running the slideshow, if you can. There you go. So, Mr. Chair, if you don't mind, I'd like to take a few minutes to tell you who we are and how we got started, believe it or not. So it's kind of unique history. Who we are, there's a company called Intelligent Imaging Systems, and there are the parent company of DriveWise, as you can see there. It started in about 2003, and we started moving forward with hardware technology at that time, and today we provide software technology and hardware for law enforcement agencies for way stations across the country. We are in over 2 million trucks across the country, so we represent about one of every four trucks that travel through the states. That's how the technology is. We're GPS-based for the DriveWise technology, and we looked at the future of cellular connectivity and Wi-Fi, and we knew that that was the future. So we developed our technology to reside as an app, just like on your smartphones, and we'll talk more about it in just a minute. I talked about 2003, so the company Intelligent Imaging Systems actually developed thermal imaging technology. And what I'm saying by that is, many of you have seen police chases of helicopters, and they show the vehicle that they're in pursuit from the aviation aircraft. And you'll see it's in black and white, and they're using thermal cameras at that point to pick up the image of the heat of the vehicle or the person running. And they sometimes look like a ghost image on your screens. That's called thermal imaging. And we actually developed that imaging system, these cameras, off hardware that we were seeing used by the military in Afghanistan and Iraq wars, thermal cameras. And with that, we can actually follow individuals and we can pick up the information from them. That's what law enforcement was using it as. This company actually said, let's use it in transportation and use it to actually look at truck safety and see if the brakes are working on trucks. Because the brakes put off heat on tractor trailers, we're actually able to see if the brakes are working on the trucks. So that's what started the Intelligent Imaging Company. We were able to take thermal cameras and actually provide highway safety techniques to law enforcement. Now, let's fast forward a little bit to 2009. We developed our...
Excuse me, yes, Mike, sir. Can I just interrupt? Where were the cameras mounted that you were taking the images from?
Yes, sir. At that time, they were actually in vans or mobile units, so we could pull up at rest areas or way stations and actually video the trucks coming through with the cameras and pick up the anomalies of the vehicles.
Okay, thank you.
2009, we actually developed software called a license plate reader that was fully automatic. It would actually capture the license plate. It would check the vehicle for all kind of safety notices from the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration for anomalies, such as the vehicle is placed out of service, such as the vehicle has no international fuel tax agreement sticker, or it's not properly registered. So those cameras could tell us that on the fly. It accompanied the thermal cameras, and we also developed something called a USDOT number reader, which would read the DOT numbers that were identifiers to that particular carrier to check to make sure they are safe. So we did all that in 2009. Now we're fast forwarding again to 2013, and that's when DriveWise was born. Basically what they did was they said, we know that cellular connectivity is the future. And these cell phones we have basically have more coverage and more information on them than the Apollo 13 spacecraft did when it was launched and went to the moon. That's how they have advanced technology. It's amazing. We took an app and basically put it on a smart device, sir. And we took that device, and knowing that it was going to be in a tractor trailer, we said, let's see if it'll actually go through way stations. And we were able to do a proof of concept in 2013. And at that point, GPS connectivity was born. So we have no readers, no hardware on the side of the road. It's all done through geofencing. And geofencing is called longitude and latitude fences. Yes, sir.
No, okay.
The truck sets the fence off. The vehicle sends the signal back to the way station, and that is how DriveWise was born, and that's why we're here today to talk about it.
Okay. We've been joined by Representative Doyle Heffley.
Sir, Mr. Representative, thank you.
And by the way, welcome to the Pennsylvania Light Show. We're pulling out all the stops to make you feel welcome here.
I didn't hear it thunder, so I figured I'm okay.
I don't know why this one's flipping on and off, but I hope it's not a distraction to you.
Yes, ma'am. Could you go back to that last slide? I had another statement on there. So we developed DriveWise, and DriveWise is very much adopted by industry in all the states across the U.S. because it was very simple to do. There's nothing that the state has to do. We put all the software in because it's in the app already in the trucks, residing in their electronic logging devices, and we'll talk more about that in a minute, which is a tablet that resides in the truck. So the software is there. We create geofences on the side of the road that activates the fences, and there is no hardware for us to install, and it's completely free for the state of Pennsylvania and all states that use our technology. So the next picture you see up there, let me go back one more time real quick. You'll see today, you'll see the coverage map of who we are, and that's just representative of how fast we had the adoption rate for DriveWise. And in the last 10 years, we were able to do this. We're in two provinces in Canada, and we're actually increasing as we speak. You see those two states that are represented to the left. Pennsylvania is Wyoming, and the other state is Iowa. Wyoming just adopted DriveWise, so that one's going to turn blue as well as Iowa. Iowa just did a pilot, so that state is now turning blue as well. So that leaves Pennsylvania, New York, and Georgia. The red states above it represent the states where we have our hardware, which is intelligent imaging system law enforcement technology. Next slide, please. So we talked a little bit about DriveWise and how it works. So we talked about it's GPS-based, does not use traditional physical transponders, so we have nothing on the side of the road that interferes with right-of-way structure or anything else. We create fences through GPS. And just like any app that you may have, sometimes they're GPS, such as Waze and so forth, it'll actually go through areas. And we actually create fences to set the device off because every device, all these cell phones, anything that has a smart device is called a GPS signal. And it actually sends the signal to our app that actually activates the app and turns it on and verifies that there is a way station ahead. As you can see right there, there's several different versions that we did, and there are different applications through the electronic logging device company. And the electronic logging device, just to make sure I clarify that, is basically a vendor that provides a tablet or smart device that goes inside of a tractor trailer. And that is the nucleus of that driver that is like the brain. They can do their manifest on it. They have their hours of service logged and their duty status. They have their fuel. They have their origin destinations, and everything they get comes off that tablet or device. And that is where our app resides. It's in silent mode in the back until it goes to a way station. Next. And this kind of tells about what the driver sees. So at 2 miles out, if I'm a tractor trailer driver and I'm coming down the road, 2 miles out, my device wakes up. By the app, it actually signals the device and wakes it up and says, hey, you're approaching a way station. And it lets that driver know, heads up, we're approaching a way station or a rest area, wherever there's enforcement activity being held. If you'll hit it one more time, it'll show one more. There we go. There's another notification that pops up when it's 1 mile out, so the driver knows that he's actually getting closer to the way station. During that time period, within a second, it's sending all the data from that tractor trailer, the tractor itself, the carrier, all the information, the DOT number, all the way to the trooper on the side of the road, to their mobile device in their patrol cars, or if it's in a way station, and it's letting them know we have a vehicle approaching. Now, the driver gets to see a response, and we'll see that in just a minute, and then I'll let Rick talk about what the troopers see. Click it one more time, dear. And this is what the driver sees. It's very simple. Bypass, they continue to bypass, or they are asked to pull in unless closed. Now, this system was built similar. We were actually building it years ago, and FMCSA developed this technology years ago for bypasses. They adopted it so that trucks could bypass. So this is nothing new. It's been around quite a while. The difference in our technology is we don't have to have readers on the side of the road, and it's all done through the electronic logging device in the trucks. It's all done through GPS and geofencing, so we don't have anything to stand up. So that makes it unique. But if you can think about, why does someone need to bypass a site? And that is simply to expedite the freight movement of that vehicle. You're identifying yourself as a good, safe carrier. Law enforcement gets to see it. And then also, it's kind of, I always phrased it as, if you go through TSA, sometimes at pre-check, you're expediting your movement through a line of trucks or people, and it's the same kind of idea. Next slide, please. And I'm going to let Rick, my colleague here, talk about what the officer sees. He ran operations boots on the ground here in Pennsylvania with state police, and he can tell you. Rick.
So this is what law enforcement sees at the roadside. This is what we call our portal. And we provide law enforcement with a picture of the truck. Some of the larger companies, it might be a representative picture of the truck. But we actually give them a picture of what the truck looks like. And that can be very key. And when you're working in a busy rest area, which truck is which? Because, believe me, it can get very confusing. We also, moving from the left to the right, we give a time, date, and stamp. So law enforcement knows at 1 mile out that truck passed through our geofence. And that's also another important part, because there's a search feature within our app that allows law enforcement to go back and search for trucks. If a truck driver might be fibbing a little bit about where he's been, we can actually follow that back and actually see where they've been. And then we have, of course, the registration number and the unit number of the truck. We tell the companies whenever they sign up with us, we are giving your information to law enforcement. Another very important part of this is each truck has a USDOT number. Each company has a USDOT number. It is their registration with the federal government. And what comes along with that is a score. A score that is either really good, really bad, or maybe middle of the road. We give that score to law enforcement instantly at roadside. And that is how law enforcement will screen the vehicle. Because when we give it to a state for a program, they have complete control of what trucks come in and what trucks can bypass, based on, in Pennsylvania's case, based on the credential scoring from the federal government. So, as I like to say in the training sessions, the trucks that aren't doing so well come in a little bit more. The trucks that are doing really well get to stay out on the road. So they kind of make their own destiny.
If I can interrupt with a question, if I'm a driver of one of those trucks, are you grading me or are you grading the truck that I'm driving?
We're grading the company that you're driving for.
Okay.
And, of course, a driver is a direct effect on what the company score is, because once they get stopped and get inspected, if there's violations, then that score goes up, which is what they don't want.
But the violations, I thought we were talking way stations. I thought the violation would be just being overweight.
Oh, no.
No,
no,
okay.
No, no. This goes way beyond weight. This goes beyond the driver's hours of service, how the company maintains their vehicles. This is everything, not just weight.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Mike, do you have a question?
Can weight be measured for the trucks while the truck is still in motion?
Absolutely. We call that mainline weigh in motion, and DriveWise works very well with mainline weigh in motion. A number of states, mostly to our south here, use mainline weighing in conjunction with driveways. So states will use weighing as a screening tool, and then they will use the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration score as a screening tool, both. So very good question.
Can I return to the one I asked a minute ago? You say they're not grading me, they're grading my company.
Yes.
Does that have any effect on me as a driver? At some point in time, do I say, look, I'm tired of driving for this company because I get bad marks, and that has some effect on my license, my CDL?
That happens
all
the time.
And do I then want to move to a different company or whatever?
Yes, that happens all the time. We see company drivers moving from company to company. Companies won't maintain their equipment, so good drivers will go to better companies.
But there's also a scenario where you could have an owner-operator, yes, where the operator is the company.
Yes, absolutely.
Right.
And we have a number of those also.
Right.
Okay, Mindy, go ahead.
Yeah, I just have a quick question. You said in Pennsylvania they would use the credential scoring from the federal government. Mm-hmm. Is
yes.
there other states use other things, or is it always that?
Oh, no, there's other states will use, if they have mainline weigh in motion, as the rep asked me. There is other states that will use, for example, Mark had talked about the USDOT reader and license plate reader. We have states that capture that also at highway speed. And that's all done 2 miles down the road. So that type of technology, especially the DOT reader, is used especially to catch trucking companies that have been placed out of service by the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. That technology is deployed in a number of states. So 2 miles down the road, law enforcement knows there's a truck coming at me, and that company's been placed out of service.
Hmm.
We want to see that truck. And, of course, that truck obviously wouldn't get a bypass in the driveway system. That's always a 100% pull-in.
And that's represented in the color code on the pull-in area.
Right.
You see the green's the bypass. And then the yellow and the orange and the red. The red is that they're pulling them in. And the neat thing about our technology, and this is so important for me to make sure I advise you, is our technology was developed by law enforcement officers. We have approximately 7 from colonels to troopers that work for us. And over the years, we've been able to fine-tune that by using law enforcement experience in motor carrier arena. So we were able to develop these type of technologies that you see by using police know-how, knowing what works. And it's all about the safety. And as you can see, those are safety scores. And we're going to pull vehicles in with bad safety scores and reward the ones that are doing the right thing by a bypass. And that helps eliminate backups on our highway systems near any kind of rest area. You might see trucks backing up on the road. That is dangerous. We've had multiple fatalities. I investigated a van that was killed because of backups. This is to help augment the operations of the trooper. The trooper still gets to do his normal job that he does, but we're able to help expedite those trucks through there in a safe manner and help the trooper as far as officer safety. It helps the driver continue on down the road. It keeps the backups from occurring. And honestly, in 30 years of it, I've seen it. You take a truck loaded 80,000 pounds, 75 feet long, for example, and they pull out from 0 to 70 mile an hour traffic around these locations. It is extremely dangerous. And we can keep traffic moving in a great manner like we've been doing. Now, Rick ran operations for years prior to our program while we're here today, but he can tell you more. But the operations were very successful, and it was a fantastic program. And Pennsylvania grabbed it initially and ran with it.
So Rick, let me go back with the better question than the first one I asked. Does
yes.
Pennsylvania do weighing of trucks that are not stationary?
I understand that there are several locations that Pennsylvania uses virtually to do that.
So scale set up at a rest stop or at a I don't think we have. Based on what the state police are telling me, we don't have dedicated weigh stations. Although I am familiar on 380 up in Lackawanna or Wayne, where we have a rest stop that's gated, but only opened when we're doing some sort of enforcement. I'm not sure
correct
where that falls in this. You know, we don't have permanent weigh stations discussion.
Well, that would be something that would be a what Pennsylvania would call a weigh station. There's also a number of locations in Pennsylvania where there's rest areas that are dual-purpose, rest area and weigh stations.
But to do the wing of the trucks that go into those, like at New Angola on 81, if you're familiar, Meve Grantville for down here, do we have scales built into the infrastructure of the facility, or do we have the mobile scales that we the trucks run over? How exactly does Pennsylvania, if we do it, measure weight while the truck is in motion?
I understand that there are a number of virtual locations that are not tied to any of your rest areas slash weigh stations, and they're not really publicized where they're at. And
so they're on the main line of an interstate somewhere?
Yes, they are.
Okay,
they are.
So that virtual is actual weighing technology.
Yes.
somewhere or some places on our interstate network in the Commonwealth where we have the ability to weigh the trucks, monitor the weight of the trucks as they pass over that particular location on that interstate.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's something that DriveWise can integrate with very, very easily.
All right. Then if that's the case, then does the state police immediately stop a trailer, tractor trailer, semi that's 90,000 pounds with no permit when it goes over one of those?
If they're on duty, if they're actually working in that area, if they're actually logged in, yes, I would assume that they would.
Okay. It sounds like a maybe more than a yes, but.
Okay. Before you get back on track, I'm just going to announce that Representative Rosemary Brown has joined us virtually. So.
Thank you, Representative. Okay,
thank you. Continue or pick up. Sorry for the interruption.
Oh, that's quite all right.
Maybe.
Good, Mark.
Okay. So we kind of talked about what the officers see, and hopefully we've been able to answer the questions. And it's all built on safety. Again, this all falls back to keywords of safety, and is to help keep trucks moving, help those drivers stay safe. Like I said, it's dangerous pulling back in and out of traffic like that. It helps the officer because if he doesn't or she doesn't have to get inside around trucks and there's trucks moving around, then that prevents them from possibly being struck by a truck, which has happened. Next slide, please. And I'll let Rick describe the screening rules since you guys did them here in Pennsylvania.
The screening rules that we used in Pennsylvania, also in other states. I spoke earlier about being placed out of service by the federal government. That happens more often than you think. When that happens, a truck is not allowed to operate, period, the company. And then that score that I spoke about starts from 1 and goes all the way up to 100. 100's the worst, number 1's the best. And we provide the information to the state with that score, and then the state sets up how many bypasses they want to allow based on that score. So in other words, we give full control to the agency so that they can screen vehicles how they want. We also can screen against violations that might be on the license plate, because once again, whenever the truck passes through that geofence, the trucking company has given us their registration. We take that registration and we run it through DMV, looking for expired stuff. We do not look for stolen, I can tell you that. We don't get to that point. We're not law enforcement. We don't have access to that. But we're looking for things that law enforcement would be interested in. Expired registrations, IFTA, which is fuel tax, UCR, which is another registration the federal government has. And the state has full control as to whether they want to see these violations or not and pull these trucks in. That's all set up. They can set it up. We guide them as to how many trucks they want to come in. And this is all done 2 miles down the road before the truck even gets there. So that's the bypass rules in a nutshell.
And the neat thing about this, Mr. Chair, I want to bring out that 2%, there's a 2% random pull-in. So nobody gets a free ride every time.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody's going to be pulled in just to make sure that they're playing with all the rules. So nobody can always bypass every site. It's always, there's an opportunity there. And actually, the 2% pull-in, the troopers can control that and actually roll it in higher. So if they say, I want 10 or 15%, or perhaps they're doing an operation where they're saying, hey, I want to look at more vehicles, they can roll it in and pull more vehicles in. So it's strictly, like I said, built by law enforcement with some high-tech folks, software folks. But we were able to do that to make this law enforcement friendly and let them have full control. They also control all the data, so they can look at how many trucks came through. When was the problematic area of these trucks? Is there certain time periods? it helps them adjust their scheduling for their law enforcement officers to be on deck. That's always important, too. So the data is theirs, or the state's, and just to answer those questions the best way I know how, it's fully controlled by the law enforcement. Any questions on this one? This, I know this is particular. And, Mr. Representative, I think you had a question earlier, too.
Well, on this one, are if the stickers truck specific? I thought if the stickers were issued to the company then just puts the sticker on either side of the truck. I didn't know that an if the sticker was truck specific.
If the company is behind in their payments, it'll show up. It is company specific, and it's not truck specific.
So if the company's behind, but the truck has the if the sticker, how do you cite that truck for not having an IFTA sticker because of the company?
You wouldn't cite them for not having an IFTA sticker. You would cite them for not being current with their IFTA registration.
Which is not truck specific.
It is not.
Okay.
It's company specific. Right. But it does show up as a flag.
Let me ask a question, if
sure.
I may. And that's, I thought that this was some sort of technology that allowed the trooper, when he sees the truck coming, or the machinery sees the truck coming, it'll tell him it's running at 79,257 pounds, so you know it's not violating any weight restrictions. And then I gather it gives you a lot more information than that. I'm trying to figure out, why would you simply say, like, bypass 20% or 30% or 60% of the trucks on the road if some of those, you know, I guess I'm not understanding all the steps of it, but if it's so instantaneous that you can tell that somebody's gone by at 87,000 pounds, why don't we just nab all of those people because they're creating, doing some harm to our roadways?
Yeah, I can address that, Mr. Chair. So what this is based upon, their safety scores. So we're looking at the safety of the driver. Generally, we found, now in not all instances, but in most cases where there is not a lot of safety provided for the carrier or the driver, there's association that's always been with overweight vehicles. We've seen that my whole career.
If a company's going to skirt the law, the drivers are probably going to
exactly.
be hired by that company. And
exactly,
but
sir.
Doesn't it eventually catch up to them?
It does. Eventually somebody gets them. And we were talking about WIMS and weigh in motion scales, and some other states, our technology is hooked up directly to it. Unfortunately, in Pennsylvania, they do have, I guess they do portable scale weighing in some sorts. They also, from what I understand, I don't know 100%, they use some weigh in motion that were data collection scales that the DOT used. Now, we can actually interface with those scales anywhere in the highway that they are.
So, Rick, in Pennsylvania, they're called weigh stations. What is the primary goal from the state police's perspective, Pennsylvania State Police perspective, with what are we trying to accomplish when the flashing lights are on I-81 for the trucks to go in? What are we trying to accomplish there? What is the goal?
They're looking to inspect trucks. They're looking to get the bad equipment off the road, the trucks that are either overweight or have bad safety scores, looking for bad tires, lights, unsafe loads.
And the only way to do that practically is to just select a random number of the trucks that are going by. You don't have enough capacity at any of these places to pull them all in and do that kind of a thorough
exam.
That
is exactly right, sir. There's the federal government realized years ago when electronic pre-screening, that's what this is called, was born. The federal government and the state governments realized all those trucks that are on the road don't fit in that weigh station.
Right.
So they came up with this idea of electronic pre-screening. Let's screen them 2 miles down the road so we can see what their safety score is. And with your question, sir, the way in motion, that is another component that can be put in to actually see the actual weight of the truck in addition to the safety score. And all this is done 2 miles down the road. And if the truck and the trucking company pass muster, why make them come in the weigh station?
But maybe we're all getting hung up on a misnomer here. I mean, we're keep calling it a weigh station. We're not weighing them because there are sensors in the interstate, or there are other states that have, you know.
In some places, yes.
So it seems to me the goal here, when I see the flashing lights on an 81, is not really to weigh the truck, but to try and figure out which ones have bad brakes and bad tires and all the rest. that the weight of the truck is, it's easier than ever to figure out whether somebody's over 80,000 pounds. And even in Pennsylvania, we have figured out that there's a way to do that.
Right.
And it sounds like there's at least a desire or a plan to try and, if somebody goes over the particular mile marker at a particular interstate at 90,000 pounds, you know, we're going to stop them along the shoulder of the road, or we're going to, you know, make them come in. These are truck inspection stations more than they are weigh stations.
In Pennsylvania, you're probably correct. The common term is weigh station, but in Pennsylvania, you could call it an inspection station, yes.
Right. And so if we're, because the average person that doesn't drive a truck, they would think that we should be able to sort out which ones are over 80,000 pounds. There's, I mean, in the year 2021, there ought to be a way for us pretty easily to figure out which of these trucks are over the 80,000 number. And then you get to, okay, now we're going to do all the other stuff that is being attempted here. And no reasonable person, I would think, would expect us to be able to do that for every truck going by at a particular milepost on an interstate. And then it's just a random selection or a more targeted random selection based on other criteria that are put into this model that you guys have with DriveWise.
Fair? Yes. Yes.
Okay. Why don't we let you get back to your presentation? We've sort of, you know, bypassed you a few times.
Oh, okay. Next slide, please. So we talked about coverage. This is what's occurring in the rest of the country. As you can see, we in 10 years, we adopted so many states because, again, the technology is superb. It's free for the state, but it was built on safety, and I can't say that enough. We've had so many officers' confessions that, hey, you know, you were able to identify these vehicles. We're able to pull vehicles in that we feel like that we needed to look at, and sure enough, we were right 100% of the time. It helped alleviate the fact that we had backups at weigh stations and the problems that occur, and we call them weigh stations, rest areas or wherever the inspection sites are occurring. So maybe that's a better term. But we were the fastest growing because we used cellular connectivity, GPS, and fencing. We didn't have to go stand towers up. They cost about, all those readers cost anywhere from $500,000 to $1 million to stand up because you got right-of-way studies with DOTs, shoulders, and encroachment, and then you have to run fiber. We did it. I can do it. We can stand something up in 24 hours. And there's some more slides that I'll show you why that benefits coming up. Next slide. So here's some benefits. As everybody says, what's the meat and potatoes behind this? What really works? Well, the benefits are the program's offered at zero cost to the agency, zero. They have two complete, I mean, they basically have the whole control of the operations. They get control who pulls in, who bypasses, all through their scoring mechanisms and the rules. They have a higher impact on safety by focusing on the limited time and attention at higher-risk vehicles. Why is that important? Well, being 30 years in law enforcement, it's hard to recruit law enforcement these days, and we're seeing the number of law enforcement, unfortunately, dwindle, and we're having to recruit and beg recruit to come get the right folks to fit and wear the uniform. So we're seeing a shortage of law enforcement across, so that gives a better chance for adoption for technology to help augment those operations. That's what we're doing here. Participating fleets, they share everything that they have in works that they can work together with a law enforcement officer and get a bypass. They don't get a whole lot, and they invest hundreds of thousands of dollars in safety annually. It's amazing. And those trucks feel like, well, the only thing that we can get out of for all the safety, too, is at least law enforcement can sometimes give us a bypass, and that's what keeps them moving. And a bypass, today's cost, you can see carriers. This was done in 1998, so you can imagine the cost factor. Every time they pull in and idle and get off the road, it costs approximately about $9 a stop for that vehicle. If they continue moving and keep moving down to expedite fleet, their food chain and supply chain, then it saves them time and money, but it also expedites the supplies from getting there. So that's another reason. The public benefits from the things I was talking about improves highway safety. Highway safety. It helps eliminate backups, possible collisions, and other things that we've seen on the roads. Next slide. And let's talk a little bit about funding real quick. I'll touch on it, and if you have questions, I'll do the best I can to answer your questions, and Rick may help me out with this. So each state is offered the opportunity by having this pre-screening It's called Innovation Technology Deployment Program that the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration provides for states that have core compliant states that offer pre-screening to identify trucks and provide data to the feds and provide data to their states' information. In return, they give them millions of dollars to increase their enforcement abilities for highway safety. And this gives a little bit of example of the states that are participating in the program. I think you may see four states that are not core compliant up there. And the state of Pennsylvania is one. Now, Pennsylvania is what is called a high crash state. They're determined by the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. I think they're probably in the top 10 as far as high commercial vehicle crashes that they have identified. And so for each state that participates in the pre-clearance program such as ours, there is a reward just for being core compliant at approximately $1 million for the state. Now, that's just one pot of money. There's three other pots of money that they have opportunities to go into to provide safety technology and to be able to purchase from other vendors or whoever the right technology to help keep truck safety available, such as the WIMS that you were talking about, such as the license plate readers that we talked about, such as the DOT readers. All those things augment the programs and help law enforcement. So there is specific funding set aside by the FMCSA. Now, we put some examples up there. If you look at the state of Delaware, I don't know if it's on this slide or not. It's hard to see with the lights. Is it on there?
Bottom.
Okay, at the very bottom. State of Delaware, we know how big Delaware is. It's not very big. They've received $10 million over the last year, and they're a small state. There is funding that I believe your state, Mr. Chair, could tap into to help augment state police operations and help the DOT. It's obvious. The money's there. Being a top 10 crash state, I think that your state could use this. Our program is one way to get there very quickly and be core compliant by having pre-clearance systems. So the funding's available. Okay. I just wanted to bring that out because I know money, if you talk to every state, they're like, well, our funding's low, our budget's low. This does provide some kind of service for you. Next slide, please. We provide these monthly reports. Rick, you talk to your states. You want to talk about it real quick?
Yeah, we provide a monthly report to each state of each location, the number of bypasses, who logs in and out of the system, how the system is used. You know, in other words, we don't just set the system up and leave. We're in constant contact with the state. We usually have two or three representatives that we talk to, and they have monthly questions. We obviously provide free training, show the officers how to use the system and use it to their advantage. The monthly report is just another benefit that we provide that, you know, we're here, we're not going anywhere. This is we're here to stay.
And you can see those demonstrations there. We provide bypasses granted, how many pull-ins were granted, the number of vehicles that actually travel through those sites, we can provide that. We break it down, hours saved by the driver, fuel, tons of carbon. I know that's big, and dollars saved. And right there is a clear demonstration for New Jersey that we can provide monthly reports. And we were in Pennsylvania when Corporal Kuntz was on deck running the operations. Next slide. We'll talk real quick about driver safety notifications. This is a service, and this is very dear to my heart, being a trooper, that we provide the truck drivers for free. Does not cost the state of Pennsylvania anything either. But what we have done is we have taken high collision areas, high rollover areas where a truck is actually overturned due to a radius curve not being constructed, right, or however you want to describe it. Low bridge ahead. If you have a low bridge and we have truck strikes that hit bridges, all these are actually geofenced through our technology, and we provide a notification a mile away for the driver as they are actually approaching them to slow down, to use judgment, and that ELD, that picture of that truck, is what pops up with a bell tone. It gets their attention, and it lets them know, danger, danger ahead, Will Robinson, as the old saying is, look out, there's something coming. That's what they're telling them. That's having a co-driver basically through technology saying, slow down. We did a a pilot with J.B. Hunt was one of our large carriers that works with us. And we went in stealth mode, which means we let them get the notification on the side of the road that DOT has a yellow flashing light, rollover area ahead. And we looked at the speeds of these vehicles. And the important thing is, and I haven't mentioned this, and forgive me for not doing it, the DriveWise app is hooked to the electronic logging device, which is hooked to the telematics of that truck, meaning we can tell what the driver does inside, if he hits or she hits her brakes, if they gear down, if they turn. We can actually tell that through a reporting system through our software. It's fascinating. So what we then did was we went back and gave them an in-cab notification. Now, I've stood on the side of the road as a trooper in Mecklenburg County, Charlotte, and we had fatalities and work zones and everything else. And we had to go, unfortunately, deliver a lot of death notifications. And I always said, as a trooper, if I can be that crew driver or let that driver know what they're approaching ahead of time, we can save lives. And that's exactly what we did. So we set up a mile away. As a truck approached, we gave them that sign right there that you're seeing, high rollover with a ping. And we saw the speeds drop by 20 miles per hour before the truck even went into the curve. And that tells us right there, these work, and we're actually making an impact on highway safety. The driver slowed down, and then the ones that don't slow down or react, that driver safety information is available in a report, so their driver safety director can go back and ask that driver, what in the world, why didn't you slow down, what's going on? So they're actually being able to help police themselves, industry is, and it's working fantastically. So we're very proud of that. That's just one slide. If you'll hit the next one, we'll show you a couple more that we're doing. And this can be done in work zones. It can be done. Here's another one. COVID response. I think your state, Pennsylvania, closed some of the rest areas. And what happened was the truck drivers were asking us which rest areas are open. They have to pull over at some point and sleep and get their hours of service. So we were able to tell them which ones were open. The trucks were able to pull into the rest areas and find temporary rest at these sites. So we were able to tell them which ones were open miles and miles down the road so they could schedule their stops at those locations. Some states actually provided us where there was troopers actually patrolling to help reduce the risk, because we actually had trucks where the trailers being, the toilet paper was being stolen out of the back during COVID. Imagine that. So we were able to use this technology to help do that. So that was just one slide I wanted to demonstrate that we can actually do these driver safety notifications. Next slide, please. And here's some more of the examples. So the Pennsylvania Turnpike uses our technology there for our truck parking. So we're able to send information ahead to the trucks, advising them of truck parking and if there was a position open, so forth. There's other opportunities that we're doing connected truck for. As you can see up there, high rollover, low bridge, steep grade, rest area. Steep grades were some of the mountain regions that we saw. We had, unfortunately, a fatality of a young driver that was inexperienced, and he did not know how to drive in the mountains of Colorado, coming out of the top of the mountains. He used his brakes up, and he went through a whole intersection, killed four people, went into the town, turned the truck over. We're able to tell the driver and signal that driver way ahead of time, 2 miles out of the mountain range, pull over, check your brakes, check your, in snow conditions, put your chains on, use your low gear. It's just common sense things, but we're actually telling them through their telematics, and it has remarkable impact on these drivers, and I'm extremely proud of that. But this bypass program, we feel, will bring safety to Pennsylvania. We know it did it before. It alleviated a lot of problems that troopers saw on the side of the road. It helped traffic move. There was no congestion when you use it like you normally have if you don't have it. And I really believe that it's a great tool for the PSP. And the good thing, Mr. Chair, is it interfaces with their ConOps. If they want to check a truck coming through, they certainly can do that. It's all a control of the technology and the software, and they have full control. So it is to augment their service and operations. I'll be glad to take any questions, sir.
I have a question with regard to the turnover sign that you were talking about. And you say the telematics can then tell you that the driver was getting this sign on his dashboard, but he didn't stop or didn't slow down. Why can't you take it one step further and, like, as it gets closer and closer, have the thing flash, you know, faster or whatever, something to get his attention. Maybe he's asleep. Maybe he's,
That's a great question. And to respond to that question, what we're able to do is we're able to keep that photo up, and we have bell tones that go off, and it gets louder and it gets louder. So we're kind of like got an alarm clock in there, and it's actually notifying that driver. I actually wanted them to have a voice on there, too, but they like the bells better than the voice.
So Mrs. Garmin could talk to them as they drive?
Yeah, I was trying to put Sling Blade on there, sir. So, Sling Blade from a movie.
I know. Did you say one in every four trucks in America today operates with this system?
Yes, sir. They have our technology on board, and the reach is out there. Not all of them are subscribers, but they can subscribe free to the notification, even if they don't have the bypass, and get the notifications for free that the truck drivers can use.
Okay. And, the three of the four trucks that don't have this system, are there other systems that are competing with you, or do we have three out of four trucks out there not having any system at all?
Yes, sir. There is a competitor that uses similar technology, so they may use their technology as well. So it could be two out of four trucks are not using preclearance. If you look at those numbers, it could be.
Okay. And do other states require this kind of hardware on all their commercial vehicles?
Yes, sir. The electronic logging device was passed by federal government, and they are required to have. And it was all done because of a collision that occurred with a tractor trailer where there were multiple fatalities and the driver had fallen asleep. So this is a requirement that was in the process, and the federal government put it in place. It's been now 2 years. We positioned our technology looking at cellular and GPS capabilities. We were looking at the future, and we knew the ELD, electronic logging device, which controls everything in that truck, hooked to the telematics, was the way to go. So we positioned ourselves to be as an app residing on that technology. So when you get it, it's just like your phone. There's apps on there. Our technology's built in there. It's just laying there to be activated.
So the federal government requires electronic logging device, and yet, you know, this is an add-on and it's an upgrade. If we come to drive, if I'm a company owner and I say I want all my trucks equipped with this, I have to come to you and say put it on. It's not something that is required by Colorado or Canada or
strictly voluntary. You're correct. It would be the owner, operator, or a carrier fleet director call us and say, we think it's a good thing, we want it on our vehicles, and this is an opportunity for us to help keep our drivers safe, keep them moving, and provide information. And then they can look at sometime the results of these signs.
And for every truck that has this hardware on it, what's it cost, and is it a recurring cost? Or is it just installation and you use it from then on?
All they pay is for it. They're just paying a subscriber fee, a monthly fee. And it could be up to $15. It could be down to $10 based upon the size of the fleets that you have.
Okay. Representative Heffley?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for coming out of this. It's fascinating what the information and technology that's out there right now. So a couple of questions. One of them, so DriveWise, who are your competitors? So if the state office say, okay, we're going to use this DriveWise technology, who else competes for this? And is there an RFP that goes out, or how does that whole system work?
Yes, sir. There is a competitor by the name of PrePass that has similar technology as ours.
And how many companies that do this?
It's just two.
Just two. Okay.
And I think, sir, to go deeper, the way the bill was constructed, it allows both competitors to come in. In many states, at least 27, we're sitting idle beside our competitors. So it gives them plenty of playing field for everybody to be there.
Yeah, if a carrier wanted to opt in to use your service.
Yes, sir.
Would they be able to, okay, we have a couple of options to choose from. We're not creating a monopoly or
that. That is correct.
It is a fascinating service. There would be a cost to the carrier. It would be kind of like a buffet. They could purchase what all they want you to provide them.
So, exactly.
Now, talking about weights, I know a lot of weights is not always gross vehicle weight. You can have a truck at 78,000 pounds, get an overweight ticket for an axle weight. Mm-hmm. When these rolling scales, how do they judge axle weights, or do they not judge axle weight? Are they not taking into account for axle weights.
If a WIM, weigh in motion scale, is tied to DriveWise, which we see in a number of states, when that truck goes over that WIM, there's an amazing amount of data comes out of that. The truck's actually weighed in 13. There's 13 different points that they look at when that truck goes over that way. It actually measures the truck. It calculates the axle weight. It calculates the group of axles. It calculates the inner bridge. It calculates the outer bridge. I could go on and on and on, bore you with all that.
Mm-hmm.
The weigh in motion scales that we use are accurate within 6%, and that is at highway speed. That's an amazing thing. We don't see a weigh in motion used in every state. We see it in some states. Some states use it, some states don't.
And then, so with that type of technology, a truck goes over the scale, they are found to be in a violation of maybe an axle weight or anything else, they get a ticket in the mail?
Oh, no. They would be directed into the inspection station or weigh station, and then they would deal with law enforcement.
We called them chicken coops back in the day. And I would just add just a little caveat. We desperately need more areas for trucks to safely park. That is something that we need to address. The other thing is the information that can be pulled out of a vehicle. You know, how much you judge how much time that the driver has on the throttle, how much the driver has on the brake, how every aspect of what they're doing. And as a tool for carriers, it's vitally important, right? I mean, it's a great tool to manage your fleet for safety and everything else. Mm-hmm. One of the things is if you have a CPAP machine, right, you have to use it if you're a commercial driver. If you don't use it, then you can be put out of service. And when you won't pass your physical if you're not reading on the card that you're using that machine when you're sleeping. So it really gets kind of personal and the amount of information that can be pulled out of there. For a carrier, for a private company, I'm cautious sometimes when we talk about how much of that information do we share with the state. I mean, if you put a computer in everybody's car, everybody would get home today and have a speeding ticket, because I can guarantee you not everybody is driving the speed limit all the time, right? So with that said, you know, in this country, you know, the speed limit is 65, but you tolerate 75, right? If you put the speed limit at 75, they're going to drive 80, and you say, okay, we're going to pull them over at 85, right? But technology is black and white. So I think I'm very familiar with a lot of these systems, and it is a wonderful tool for carriers. It has really shown that a lot of the accidents that happen on the road are not the carrier's fault. It's been a tremendous tool for liability protection.
Shows driving habits.
Yeah. So with that said, I think this is a good technology. I mean, getting trucks in and out of the scales, it was always an issue, pulling over, blending back into traffic, stopping on the road, trucks backed up onto the shoulder. So I think there's a lot. I think it's really important. I read over the bill. I'm glad really thank the chairman for holding this here, and I think it's a good tool for carriers that opt in. But I'm very cautious as to how much we want to continue to share with the state. Right? We just went through a pandemic where people were told they can't drive. We want to, like, people are like, okay, the truck's moving. We're going to shut it down. You could shut the truck off. You get an alert. When I was in back in the day, I managed my fleet. I would get an alert on my phone anytime I had a truck going 15 miles an hour over the speed limit, or if they had a sudden stop. There's a lot of tools. So I think as we proceed with this, I think we need to be very cautious as to how much information we want to share and what the carriers would have to share with the state. So, but other than that, thank you very much for holding the hearing.
Thank you, Dole.
Luke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The first thing I'd like to say is that I never speed unless it's an emergency, and I may have a more expansive definition of emergency than some others. But the question I had was, there's so much information that can be passed back and forth with law enforcement with your system. Is there any way that your system interfaces with the Amber Alert system at all? And if you could explain that, please.
Yeah, that's a great question. We're actually looking into that right now. There has been a lot of information, and we can actually send notifications out to drivers. Some of the projects, just to expand on it, if you don't mind, Mr. Chair, while I have the floor.
Go
What we're able to do in some areas is, and we have one, is called congested traffic notifications, where we're working with a partner. So if we have a slowdown of traffic, if we have a sudden stops, if we have someone standing in the road, we can actually send that information miles ahead to those drivers to get them to slow down. Now, that's another part of our business, and there is charges on that, where it's not zero cost, because there's a lot of software has to be done. But we're able to send real-time messages, dynamic messages to drivers of trucks. Same thing with the Amber Alerts. We're working with some folks right now to be able to provide locations and informations for Amber Alerts. There's all kind of things that we have prioritized in our roadmap, and thank you for bringing that. I have been a trooper. I keep saying, let's send an Amber Alert. We don't want to overflood the driver with too many messages, or then they become passive and they won't even respond. We're fearful of that. But things such as Amber Alerts, or if there is a emergency situation ahead, we certainly want to be able to broadcast that. And I'll give you a prime example, and thank you for that question. It's important. The bridge that went out in Arkansas and Tennessee, losing $2.5 million a day in freight to cross it. I work very close with the Trucking Association execs in those states, and they will tell you that the truck bridge there was tremendous and impacted the supply chain there. We were able to instantly, within an hour, send those messages to all these EOD vendors that we work with in these trucks and provide routes and locations of where this is out, take another route. We work very close with the DOT and the emergency management in those states. So we were able to take those drivers out of those situations. It's the same thing with Amber Alerts. We can provide that once we get it. We are working in that field. We just had floods in North Carolina, historical floods that wiped out communities. We were able to send messages to drivers and get them away from those areas so they could use other routes. Same thing in Tennessee we're working on right now still. They're going through some challenges. So it is unbelievable what we can do with this technology and how we can keep drivers and the public safe.
I was just going to say, it sounds like the your system has great potential in terms of public safety.
Absolutely. And it was built with law enforcement, so I get to throw that gig in that, yes, sir, we developed it pretty good with those smart ones, as I call them.
Well, thank you, gentlemen, for being here today, and thank you very much for your testimony. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Lou. Mike?
All right. Rick, you're with the Pennsylvania State Police during the time that the pilot or pilots were underway?
Not the pilot. We actually used the program whenever I was still working. I've been
okay,
retired
so maybe
5 years.
It was not a pilot.
So when Driveway was being contemplated or was being implemented as a temporarily in Pennsylvania, you were with the state police at that time.
I was not. I was with Driveway at that point.
The Pennsylvania State Police have taken a position of opposition to this under a couple of different banners, but the one for me that sticks out is allows the avoidance of a motor carrier inspection. What would be the rebuttal to the state police's objection that this sort of technology allows for the avoidance of an inspection?
My comeback to that would be that based on the safety score, currently the state police are just randomly picking trucks. They're just, we're going to take this truck. There's no screening going on without an electronic pre-clearance program. That's what we do. We show them up front the safety score of the truck that's coming at them a mile, 2 miles down the road, and it enables law enforcement, in this case Pennsylvania, to pick out those trucks that have worse scores rather than better scores, or a truck that chooses not to participate in any program at all.
So right now, the flashing lights are on 81. Every truck has to come in. A truck ignores the lights, blows by. I would like to think, and I believe, that some trooper in that stop is going to go out, pull them over.
You would hope.
Right. With reasonable expectation that likely scenario would play out. So this gets implemented in Pennsylvania. I'm behind the wheel of the semi, and I just pretend I got the avoid, or whatever the right word is.
Bypass.
Bypass, thank you. What happens? So the driver pretends he got the bypass, but he really didn't get the bypass, and he bypasses.
So
what
the,
happens?
So the officer that's sitting in the inspection station sees the truck bypass, checks the driveway screen, doesn't see that company. We provided them a picture of the truck, or at least, you know, some generalized picture. He identifies that truck as not being on the driveway screen. He realizes that's not a driveway truck. That's not, that truck wasn't given any kind of bypass at all. He should go out, pull it over. And when I do the training, that what is on the screen, on that electronic screen, is actually on his electronic device. He can't change that. So if he says, well, I got a bypass from DriveWise, okay, let me see it. And, of course, it may not be there. He might have fibbed.
And then you have to reconcile that scenario with the unsubscribed folks.
Right.
So now you have unsubscribed trucks heading towards the flashing yellow lights.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the rules of the game for them remain as they currently are.
Absolutely.
They want to try and roll the dice to blow by. That's what exists today.
Right. Exactly. The classic blow by, as we call it.
Okay. I didn't know that phrase, but I guess I'm just trying to reconcile, the state police's opposition here. It seems a little, sort of the Pennsylvania allergy to change. We're never big on change. I hope that the state police somewhere along the way can come forward and explain, exactly what the concerns are. I mean, 47 other states have found a way to do this, but we have to make sure that we reconcile the need to have safe trucks on the road. I'm certain that you would agree with that.
Absolutely.
And with the number of miles of interstate that we have in the state and the volume of truck traffic we have in the state is superior to almost any state in the nation. I mean, certainly we have no better example than I-81 between 78 and 83, for God's sakes. I guess I'm just trying to understand what the concern is, because we do not have a perfect system today. People can bypass the inspection station if they want to roll those dice. And I guess I'll stop with the monologue, but I'll stop. Thank you.
If I could answer your question, sir. I spent 27 years with the state police. Of that 27 years, I probably did DOT work, inspection work around trucks, probably 24 of those 27 years. I was a local officer for 7 years before that. I've been around trucks. When I saw this system and how it works, and especially now that I work for the company and have seen how this system works in other states, I wouldn't work for this company if I didn't believe in it. Electronic pre-screening is the way to go. It's the future. Once again, I go back to all those trucks don't fit in that weigh station. And for Pennsylvania to continue to go down the road of, well, we're going to pick this truck today and hope that, you know, maybe I'll find something. Whereas if you use electronic pre-screening, we're doing a lot of your work for you 2 miles down the road. And we're showing it to you on the screen, what's coming at you.
Okay, Representative Fee.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for your testimony, both of you gentlemen. But a couple things. What was really important to me was, number one, that even small carriers I have a neighbor who drives truck, mm-hmm. could afford this.
Sure.
Obviously, from our crash rates, like you described, Pennsylvania is not doing a great job as it stands right now. So if it's a voluntary technology, and to me, really, in the end, what it comes down to is the people who are following the rules and doing a good job and doing it right get awarded by being able to stay on the road and keep moving and get products to all of us who are, by the way, calling Amazon every other minute right now. So, yeah, to me, it just is a no-brainer. So thank you. Thank you again for your testimony.
Thank you, Madam Representative. We appreciate that. And the fact that we get to come in and discuss it and try to answer any questions. And, again, you heard Corporal Kuntz and old Major here tell you, with gray hairs, tell you about our technology. I wouldn't be here either. I looked at it, and I studied a lot of things before when I retired, and I got retired real young. 47. So I spent a lot of times in the aircraft searching for people. I had mobile field force and all the fun toys that everybody said, motorcycles and the whole canine and everything else. But when we looked at this technology and I started reviewing it, I was the first one to get to sit in there and look at the app in place. And I said, if we can do that and implement it in trucks, we can help these law enforcement officers be able to do their job more efficiently. Efficiency is important. Expedite the transportation of our supply chain and these drivers and keep them moving. Save them fuel and time. Reward them for something because they work awful hard just like troopers do. Give them something. And to me, it's just like Rick said, I saw this as a future. And you know, if you think about autonomous vehicles and what's coming down the path, we've got to use technology to help augment our normal duties. And with the shortage of law enforcement, as we're seeing, and it's continuing to get worse, we've got to use technology. And it's just one way that we can help our communities be more safer and our motors be more safer. So I certainly appreciate the opportunity, sirs, ma'ams, to be with you today and be able to answer any questions. I'll take any other.
Okay. Thank you. Representative Heffley.
So just you had said that, like, if a carrier signs up for this, like you said it would be like a 2% inspection rate if a carrier has a good CSA score, right? And or you said it could go to 10% or 15%. So does if a carrier signs up for it, are they buying into a 2% inspection rate? Who determines that? Is that a contractual thing? Or who can say, like, hey, maybe we're going to say it's a slow day, we're going to go 50%. I mean, is there anything that limits what they can do with that? Or because the carrier is saying, hey, well, we're buying into 2%, because I'd buy into 2%.
That's a great question. to respond to that question, Mr. Representative, one of the things that we did was we let the state have control of pull-in rates and random rates. Mm-hmm. So they start their day off, they check the block, and they actually say, I need a 10% today. I feel 10. I'm going to look at 10% of the carriers to make sure they're above board. So they do that. And our subscribers know that. It's the opportunity that they can have a bypass for doing the right things, but they don't know which state may do it. It's a best practice guide that a lot of states use, a 2% random pull-in, and that just keeps everybody aboard at the even playing field, as they're saying, that you could be pulled in. Okay. Rick, do you have anything to elaborate on that?
It's totally up to the state. We leave that control totally up to them. There are days, you seem very familiar with the trucking industry, you know there's days whenever it's hazmat day. We want to see all the hazmats. So they'll turn the bypass, they'll turn it up to 100%. Okay. We see that. We expect that. It's brake check day. It's, we see that.
Yeah, I just yeah. My question was more or less, okay, so if you're selling a product to a carrier, That was my question. Like, what are you selling them? The states are still going to be able to. Because I think, yeah. I mean, just to go back to your joke about either carrier wants 2% inspection or 0%. But here's the thing: carriers, every driver that gets in a truck that day wants to come home that night, exactly. Right? They want to go out, deliver the freight, and come back safely. I mean, that's the goal of everybody, right? I mean, carriers want to put safe trucks on the road, so they're out there doing everything they can. You do have, you know, carriers that maybe run into an issue here and there, but you know, I think that, and quite honestly, if you go over any car in a parking garage downstairs right now, you could probably find some kind of safety infraction somewhere. It's why every time you take it into a shop, it's why you have an inspection. But I mean, carriers, they inspect their fleets every day before they go out, every day when they come back, and in between. So. So with that said, I think it's a good technology. I think it's just some privacy things that we want to make sure that we get right if we go this route. So, but thank you.
Thank you, Doyle. Rick, Mark, across the nation, how many states vest the control of this system in their Department of Transportation vis-a-vis the state police, rather. I'm sorry, because you know we start off when when Mindy filed the bill, the control was going to be by PennDOT, and now at her request we changed it to Pennsylvania State Police, and maybe there's some disagreement about that. Maybe we'll have to look into that. But how many states across the nation? I think you said 48 states have bought into this, or 46. Most of the time, are you dealing with the state police? In the state, or are you dealing with the Department of Transportation?
It's a mixture of both. It's generally state police or state highway patrol. There are those states that have their own Department of Transportation, police, or law enforcement officers. For many, for example, Mississippi just actually merged with the highway patrol there. They had DOT police. But some of their police officers, it's a mixed bag of fruit, sir. So you may have law enforcement officers that are serving and they are authorized through the Department of Transportation, working at scales or at rest areas or wherever. There's generally a state trooper also with them conducting inspections and doing size and weight operations. So it's a mixture, if that helps answer anything.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out if there's some gravitas to having the state police run the thing or being the final voice as opposed to the Department of Transportation. It would seem to me we're talking enforcement here. The state police would seem to be the logical place for it to reside.
Yes, sir. Our response would be that would be correct because they have to check off when they turn it on, and Rick, and correct me if I'm wrong, they check the blocks of what they want to see today. Do I want to look at all these trucks with all these violations for IFTA, IRP, whatever it could be? Do I want to check those and have them all come in, or do I want to check today? I'm just going to look at IRP violations and see if there are any and keep the trucks moving. They have the authority to run that program themselves, and that's why it's whoever is actually stopping the vehicles and pulling the vehicles in, that's who needs to be in control of it. Rick, you agree?
And in most states, I will go along with Mark, when you're dealing with law enforcement, that is who we normally deal with one-on-one. But we also deal with DOT because, as we all know, who owns the rest areas?
Mm-hmm.
DOT. And, of course, that's where our equipment would reside. So they definitely need to be involved. So, but at the end, it's the state police.
Okay, real quick. IFTA stands for?
International Fuel Tax Agreement. If they have to pay that, yes, sir.
And the RFP stands for?
International Registration Plan. So each truck has to pay the state to operate in it. That's their sales tax. I mean, their highway tax for fuel tax or whatever you would like to reside. So there's a fuel tax and then there's a road tax that they're paying that state to operate in Pennsylvania, if that makes sense. If I have my own trucking company, I got to pay Pennsylvania to operate through it.
Okay. That's just to answer the questions that might be on the phone when we get back to the office.
Oh, yes, sir.
People are asking, what are they
and I apologize for
one
not describing
question.
Them better.
That's right. I think you said that Pennsylvania was a high crash experience state or compliance state, whatever
yes,
the terminology
sir.
Was. Is that because of the western part of our state is, you know, our turnpike has a lot more hills and valleys and twists and turns in the western part of the state than we have in the east. Is the topography of the state the reason we are more crash, higher crash experience rate?
Well, to answer that, and I'll let Rick address Pennsylvania specifically, but North Carolina is one as well. Because I-95 corridor and the congestion of traffic on the East Coast, such as Philadelphia and the whole area to the east, anywhere you got high volumes of traffic, you're going to have more collisions. And these are generally long haulers, not your peddlers that are involved, which are short distance haulers. And that we're seeing that because of the mere congestion that we're dealing with in these interstate systems. And it's like we were talking earlier, one vehicle slows down and stops. It takes at 55 miles an hour, the length of a football field, to stop that vehicle at 80,000 pounds. So they just can't stop in time. And most of the times, it's because somebody slams on the brakes and the truck, unfortunately, can't stop. So geographic area does play a role in it, from the mountains to the coast. But
mainly volume.
Mainly volume. And plus, Pennsylvania is the gateway to the Northeast.
Keystone State.
You can't get to New Jersey generally unless you go through Pennsylvania, New York, Maine. So we're the big funnel, and we are a top 10 crash state.
We're proud of our nickname, the Keystone State. Mindy, have you?
Yeah, I forgot to ask one other thing. The federal funding that you talked about where Delaware was eligible for all the funding, does the state police apply for that? That money gets funneled directly to the state police, or is it?
That's a mixture.
Okay.
That's a mixture of the state police and DOT. For example, I spoke earlier about the virtual way stations, the way in motion stuff. Delaware is full of them. The state of Delaware has approximately maybe 15 people that do inspections. 15. We have over 700 in Pennsylvania.
Oh.
So 15.
But Delaware has been very crafty in what they do with technology. We showed you the kind of money they get, and they use it very wisely.
Yeah, you would think they would. Our agencies would want to tap into that.
One would think so.
Thanks.
Okay. You know, no one else asking to be recognized. We want to thank you very much for your patience. Thanks for enduring the light show we were presenting for a while with all the blinking lights. I don't know what was happening there. But you've really opened a lot of our eyes as far as what this system can do, what it's capable of, what it might be even, you know, better capable in future years. I like the idea that if it monitors a truck going too fast coming to a turnover curve, it ought to get louder, it ought to get brighter, it ought to, like, wake up, you know, and just hit the brakes, slow down so you don't have the turnover.
Yes, sir. And, you know, the neat thing about this technology, and we're very fortunate, Rick and myself, we work with a group of engineers and software developers and programmers, and they're from all over the world, and they're brilliant. And with the State Highway Patrol, it would cost me millions of dollars to implement some kind of program, and it'd take years to do it. And with these folks and these young techies, as I call them, when the old major comes in from North Carolina, they call me Andy Griffin, sir. When I show up, they say, what kind of ideas do you have today? And it's the ideas like you just said a few months ago, and getting louder or flashing. It comes from the drivers that we talk to every day. It comes from law enforcement in every state that we deal with. We're very blessed. We take those ideas and we shoot them up the command. And they never say no. They prioritize them and see if they can work them in. So we're very fluid, changing everything we're doing to improve it. And it's all in the name of highway safety and making these drivers safer and our roads safer and providing a safe haven for our troopers, law enforcement.
Well, again, thank you for your testimony. Thanks for what you do to make our highways safe.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And Madam Representatives, thank you.
Thank you. We're adjourned.